Welcome, everyone. Good evening. Thank you so much for joining us again as we end the Lord's Day together, for coming back down to church. It will be a wonderful evening. I have just one announcement for you as we begin, and it's on the back of your bulletins. Our McKnight Lecture Series began today, and it will run for several consecutive Sundays with this idea of being known, shame, sexuality, and community. It was going to be a really rich time during our Sunday school hour for the next few weeks. So just remember that, and it'd be a great opportunity to invite friends. I should say, along with that, that for two of those weekends, there's an additional seminars on Saturdays that you can sign up for. Go to the website, look at the announcement sheet, and you'll know all you need to know for that. Now, tonight, Reverend John Barrett is going to preach through our series of knowing God, the God you can know, on the attributes of God, and he's going to talk tonight about the eternality of God. You're going to know everything you need to know about God's eternality after tonight because of John Barrett. So look forward to that. Let's say our catechism, though, because this is where our series comes from. Page 11, shorter catechism, question number 4. It's our aim to say this every Sunday night this summer. What is God? God is a spirit, infinite, eternal, and unchangeable in his being, wisdom, power, holiness, justice, goodness, and truth. Would you please stand? I want to call us to worship with these first two verses from Psalm 90 that remind us of God's eternal nature. Listen to this. Lord, you have been our dwelling place throughout all generations. Before the mountains were born, or you brought forth the earth and the world, from everlasting to everlasting, you are God. Let's pray together. Oh, Holy Spirit, would you descend upon this place this night, that we would understand more and more of the nature of the God who has revealed himself to us in Jesus Christ and is the God we can know personally. Capture our hearts, our minds, our wills, our affections with the promise that our God has always been. He is outside of time and he always will be. Help us to trust that God. Cause us now to worship you in spirit and in truth. We pray in Jesus' name. And all God's people said, amen.
Thank you. to the altar, the Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness is born with the precious blood of Jesus Christ. Amen.
Invite Courtney Owens to come up at this time. Courtney is here representing Lily Moms. We are very grateful that you are here and very thankful for Lily Moms and the ministry that you lead. And we're so thankful. I see many of our leadership team here as well. I'm going to ask you a few questions.
Yes, sir.
Courtney, where were you born?
Houston, Texas.
When did you move here?
3 years ago.
Okay, that was all stalling. Here's the real question. How has Lily Moms impacted you the most?
So I was raised outside of the church. I was not churched as a child. And when I was pregnant with my first child living in New Orleans, a friend invited me to what was MOPS at the time. And I froze and said, "You want to bring this non-church person to a church group?" And she said, "I do, you'll love it." And I walked into a room full of diverse women, some that had amazing relationships with the Lord and some were at the same place as I was. And because of that year in MOPS, I formed a relationship with God because of the grace that these women showed me. I joined my first church when we moved to Oklahoma, and I was baptized in North Augusta last year in February, and it all started because I walked through those doors one day.
Wow. I had no idea. That's a wonderful story.
Yep.
Tell us the impact that Lily Moms is having on our local community.
So we strive to work with our local community. We work really closely with Connected Hearts Ministry, who works with foster children in our area and with people that are adopting special needs children. And so every year for the past 3 or 4 years, we have done foster bags. We write verses on the bags, we decorate them, and then we stuff them with a Bible, stuffed animal, blanket, a change of clothes, because most foster children are taken out of their home in the middle of the night. And so these kids leave with a black grocery bag, and it has the very few things that they can grab before the police take them out. And so these bags are given to these children when they get to a new home, and they have a stuffed animal to love on and Jesus to read about. And we write them a card, and we just tell them that we're praying for them and we're thinking about them, and that somebody out there loves them and that they're going to be protected.
Now, this is not on our script, but you're doing so well that
Thanks.
I'm going to ask you. Just describe to everyone here what happens at the Lily Moms gathering. What day do y'all meet here?
We meet twice a month on Tuesday mornings from 10 to 12. We start by having a morning prayer, and we have a nice brunch together without a child to interrupt our food because we have childcare. And so Lily Moms is for women with children up to the age of kindergarten, your youngest one. And so we do have childcare, and we meet, we have a brunch together. One of our mentor moms, Donna Jones, leads our mentor moms, and they give us a devotional together. And then we can do anything from our philanthropy work to having a speaker. We've done marriage panels. We have done craft days. We've done game days where we just hang out together. But most of all, we're spending our time together to become closer to God while growing in our relationship with other moms that are in the same stage of life as us.
That's great. Tell us how we can pray for Lily Moms.
We would love to open the doors to the local community and people that are unchurched. Most of Lily Moms is women that are churched, and that's how they've heard about it. My best advice is that we can offer it to any mom that we meet. I will tell any mom at the grocery store or the playground that I meet, and they all make fun of me because they say half of our group comes from me just talking to everybody, but that's fine. I want us to reach the moms that don't go to church and don't know about Lily Moms and that may be afraid to walk into the doors of a church and feel, you know, afraid, or that they would be judged, or that they're not perfect in God's eyes, so why would they come? And those are the women that we want to have in there. We want to make them feel loved and welcomed and cherished and just be a guiding light for them. So we would just pray for more diversity in our local community to come in.
Do we need more locations?
We have a lot of locations. There's not any in North Augusta. Most of us from North Augusta come here, but there's one in Grovetown. There's one in Harlem, I think. But we do have multiple locations around the Augusta area. There's 4 chapters now.
But you want us to reach more moms?
We do, especially locally here in downtown Augusta.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
We should clap for Courtney. You Presbyterians, I'd ask the ushers to come forward. We'll receive this evening's offering and pray together. Thank you, Courtney. That was wonderful. Let's pray now. Eternal God, unchangeable, the one who has always been and always will be, the one who has brought people from darkness to light, like Courtney, like so many in this room, we praise you for your grace that found us through the community, through the ministries, through the church, through different vehicles that you have given. We praise you, Lord, for your church, the body of Christ, and we ask that you would take these gifts and build your church and all of her ministries that extend into this community, to our missionaries around the world. We thank you for the great summer we are already having. We remember our youth who are in Germany now, transform their hearts as they are missionaries for these 10 days, and use them to bring many to Christ at the camp they are working at there in Dresden. We thank you for the Ingrams and their ministry there. They represent all of our missionaries that we right now bring before the throne of grace, and we ask that you would do a mighty work in their hearts. Send them your peace and your comfort and your joy, and use them. Lord, establish the work of your hands. And we pray locally for Lily Moms with great thanksgiving for those that have been won to Christ through the relationships, for the ministry that has gone on through Lily Moms to this community, in particular to foster children and families. And we pray that you would grow that ministry to reach many moms. We understand in part just how lonely and difficult the work is for our moms. We pray that you would give them rich community, and that they would ultimately find that community in the person of Jesus Christ as they join together. Thank you, Lord, for what you're going to do through these gifts now. And we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
As we take our offering, I want to invite you both in your bulletin, or you can follow the screen. In the bulletin, we're going to sing Psalm 115, and you will sing the bold portion. And Kelly will read the non-bold.
Not to us, Lord, not to us, but to your name glory give. For your steadfast love and grace, for your covenant faithfulness, why should heathen nations say,
heaven is. He does all that pleases him. Their gods are of silver, gold, fashioned by the hands of men. They have mouths but do not speak. They have eyes but do not see. They have ears but do not hear. Noses have but do not smell. They have hands but do not touch. And they have feet but they do not walk. In their throat they make no sound. Such all who them make or trust.
Israel, trust in the Lord. He's their strength and he's their shield. Aaron's house, trust in the Lord.
Thought of us, mindful still, he'll bless us now. He will bless all Israel's house. He will bless all Aaron's house. He will bless all who fear the Lord, whether they be small or great. May the Lord so add to you that your numbers will abound. As generations pass, may your children still increase. Blessed be you of the Lord, he who made the heaven and the earth.
Of the Lord, earth he's given to sons of men. Dead ones will not praise the Lord, nor those bound for silent grace.
please sing.
Please open in your Bibles to Psalm 90, which can be found on page 929 if you're using the Pew Bibles in front of you. Tonight we will continue our series on the attributes of God. A study of the attributes of God answers questions like, what is God and what is God like? It's often organized, the attributes, by the catechism, which is what we're using. But even within the catechism, there's a division between God's attributes, between those which are incommunicable, which are attributes he does not share with us. An example of that might be his omnipresence. It's impossible for us to be everywhere at the same time. But then there's the communicable attributes, those attributes which he does share with mankind, like his gentleness. That's something that we, in fact, can exhibit. I have a slide here. I just want to show this to you. I know you can't see it at all, but I want to commend a resource to you. It's visual theology. It's a great way just to learn about a lot of theology with great visuals that they in fact do provide. Tonight I'm going to be looking at the incommunicable attribute of God's eternality. As we kick this series off, I mentioned that one of the reasons that the attributes of God are often neglected, it's just because they seem so impractical to us. How in the world will it help me become more faithful, loving Christian if I think about God's eternity? Well, that's what we're going to attempt to do tonight. I'm going to read Psalm 90, verses 1 through 2, the same verse that we began our service with. Lord, you've been our dwelling place throughout all generations. Before the mountains were born, where you brought forth the earth and the world from everlasting to everlasting, you are God. Let's pray. Our great God and Father, you are from everlasting to everlasting. And there's no way that within my own strength or power or words that I can give these your people a taste of who you are and what that means for them without the work of your Spirit. So I would pray now that you would use me and use these words that we might consider you and what you mean for our lives in new and fresh ways. We ask this in Christ's name. Amen. Time is, in fact, difficult for us to understand. Jen Wilkie, in her book, None Like Him, gives the illustration that when she was in kindergarten, she remembers her teacher, about midway through the year on a Monday morning, all the students had those fat pencils that kindergartners had, and she began to teach the concept of time to them. And she said, write this, today is Monday. And all the little students began to write, today is Monday. Tomorrow is Tuesday. And they began to write that down. Yesterday was Sunday. And all the students wrote that down. She said, and harmony reigned. The next day, school begins. Students, get out your pencils. Let's write this down. Today is Tuesday. A couple of the brighter students began to look around confused. Yesterday was Monday. And one little student said, Miss Greek, you said that today is Monday. No, she said, Monday is now yesterday. And all the students just looked baffled. They thought to themselves, how in the world can we trust this woman with anything if she can't even keep the days of the week straight? Well, what was the problem there? Was it the message itself? No, the problem there was the limited ability of those hearing it to understand it. Tonight, as we discuss this incommunicable attribute of eternity, we will quickly find ourselves in a position where our limitations are in fact met. But I hope that three truths are communicated tonight as we move forward. The first is that God is eternal. He has given us eternal promises that we might have the hope of eternal life. That's where we're headed tonight. Point one, God is eternal. There's really three marks of God's eternality. The first is that he is without beginning. If you're one of those people who's filling in the notes, that's the first thing to write. He is without beginning. He existed before creation. Genesis 1:1, scriptures open. In the beginning, God created. If he was there at the beginning, then we know that he had to be there before creation. Well, just how much before creation was he? If I were to show you 100 $1 bills and stack them together on top of one another, it's about half an inch. If I were to stack 1 million $1 bills, it would reach about 30 stories of a building. The Lamar building is 19 stories, the tallest building in Augusta, so it's going to surpass that. If we were to stack 100 million $1 bills, it would reach the heights of commercial jetliners. You know, the ones really high in the sky that you can just see the vapor mist coming out of them. If we were to stack 100 trillion $1 bills, it would reach the moon, which is about 250,000 miles away, back and forth 14 times. And yet, when we begin to consider whatever number, hundred of millions of trillions of years that there was before the creation of God's eternality, we still would not touch on the infinity of numbers of days and time before creation itself. God is without beginning. Also, God is without end. Our text says that He is from everlasting to everlasting. One of the chapters I read, the Puritan writer Stephen Charnock, I'm going to quote three times for him tonight. Here's the first. He said this: He will continue in being as long as He already enjoyed it. And if we could advance millions of years, we would still be as far from the end as from the beginning. Take you back to my ninth grade geometry class. First day, Mrs. Smith stood at the chalkboard. We still had chalk and a chalkboard. We were transitioning to the whiteboards, though. But she said, I'm going to start with these three terms you have to know if you can understand geometry. A line segment, a ray, and a line. She walked up to the board and she did a really dark dot. Then she drew a line and she did a really dark dot at the end of it. She said, that's a line segment. It has a beginning and it has an end. She then went and she erased one of the endpoints and she drew an arrow on it. She said, this is a ray. And she took her chalk and she started to walk down the chalkboard. She got to the end of the chalkboard and she just kept walking. She took the chalk and she drew on the wall. She goes, a ray keeps going and it keeps going. She got to the window. Then she said, the ray goes out the window, over the football field, over the Winn-Dixie, over the city, into the galaxy, beyond the galaxy. It just goes forever. And after I got over the shock of her writing on the wall, I thought to myself, forever. She goes, and if that's not interesting enough, let me tell you what the line does. And she went back and she erased the other endpoint. She did the same exact exercise, and the line went the opposite direction. She goes, it goes, and it goes, and it goes. I don't remember anything she said the rest of the class period. I just sat there drawing little arrows on a sheet of paper and just thinking about them going in both directions forever. Our lives are an infinitely small line segment. A little beginning and a little end. God is infinitely infinite. He's a line. He goes in both directions forever. God is without beginning, God is without end, and God is without change. When you woke up this morning, you scurried around your house, got yourself ready, came down to the church. At some point you realized you're going to be late, or maybe early. You went home today, had lunch, supper, whatever you call it, took a nap, enjoyed the day, woke back up, put yourself back together, look at the clock at some point, drove down to the church. You knew how much time you had to do these things. This is how we experience time. It's moment by moment. Seconds turn into minutes, minutes turn into hours, hours turn into days, days to years, years to decades. And over time, there is a progression. There is a change within our lives. Someone a couple of weeks ago walked into my office. There's a picture of me just before I married Amber. She and I are together. He looked at it, he goes, wow, you look so young there. And I looked at it, and for the first time, I thought to myself, he's right. What happened? 20 years is what happened. It seemed like it was just like that. But over time, there is a progression in all of us. There's growing, and there's declining. This past week, I turned 44. And let me tell you, what that means is that now this body is declining. Today alone, I lost 10,000 neurons. Now, we started with 100 billion, but still, today, 10,000. At the age of 40, the heart, it's on the decline in terms of its strength. The blood vessels, which are so essential, carrying blood top to bottom, the elasticity which once defined them, it starts to move in the opposite direction. That is the reason that that happens in all of us, is that there is a stronger force working against my body at this point, that it is on the decline and that change is coming. Second quote, but God receives nothing as an addition to what he was before. He loseth nothing of what he was before. He is always the same excellency and perfection in the same infiniteness as ever. His years do not fail. His years do not come and go as others do. There is not this day, tomorrow, or yesterday with him. God is eternal. He's without beginning. He is without end. And he's without change. Here's my transition point here. And I think this might be the most important statement I'm going to make all night. This is what really ministered to me this week. Because God is eternal, we now have unchanging, eternal promises that are ours in Christ. His eternal nature allows him, causes him to give us eternal promises. I want to take you back a moment before creation. In the beginning, Genesis 1, I'm moving before that, into this infinite expanse. Stephen Lawson jokingly said that in this expanse, in that period, is when the first board meeting ever took place. It was an inner Trinitarian board meeting. It was a meeting between God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. And in this meeting, a set of plans was devised that we call the decrees of God. They met together and they determined how things in this world were going to be. Steve Lawson says they could have made the sky green and the grass blue. They could have created no tides, but instead they created low tides and high tides. They considered all of what was to take place, and in their infinite wisdom, they eventually came up with a set of plans, a set of detailed plans. When we first started to dream about the Ebenezer building, which is our children's ministry building just over here, the first set of drawings we received were 6 artistic renderings. They're colorful, they're watercolors. Now, could you imagine if on the first day that we were to begin construction, we took those 6 drawings and gave them to the contractor, and we said, we want this. Start today and begin to build this. Well, of course, that's not how it works. He would say, no, we need blueprints. I walked into the contractor's office one day, hundreds of blueprints, detailed drawings of what this construction was going to look like. In this inner Trinitarian deliberation, God the Father, God the Son, and God the Spirit, they worked out this detailed plan. They created this plan as to what was going to take place in this world from the beginning of creation until the end. That's your first fill in the blank there. Plan created. The second thing, a covenant was established. Once they created this plan, they covenanted themselves together to ensure that it would come to fulfillment. Our friend Dr. Vasholtz, he wrote a small little booklet and he offered it to all the members of the church. And I would encourage you, if you've not read it, to just to read it. He said this about that moment of the Trinity coming together. At the foundation of the world, the triune God shook hands and put themselves under the bonds of love. God put himself under the pledge of his own doing. God will never forget or fail in the covenant he has made. He doesn't want to. Spurgeon said this, "It's impossible that God the Father, God the Son, and God the Spirit will be at cross purposes with one another." Over the years, I've read a lot about these covenants, covenant theology, for a lot of different authors. And what's always interesting to me is when they get to this point where they're trying to describe the strength of this promise, the strength of this bond that was established, they always get to this point and they say, it is, and then they drop a word that is not part of my common vernacular. It's a word that isn't something that we use in our everyday language. Dr. Vasholtz said when describing this covenant, he said the plan is irrefragable. That's not a word that I use that often. It's undisputed. It cannot be fought against. It's stronger than Gorilla Glue. It's more powerful than that Flex Seal paint. That's what he's trying to... They do that because they want you to understand this is not your ordinary type of bond that has taken place here. And what in fact did the Trinity that day seek to accomplish? The last point you have there. Our immortality was secured. At that moment, God the Father, God the Son, and God the Spirit ensured our immortality. We see this language in Genesis 1:26, which is what Dr. Vasholtz spends a lot of his time looking at. It says, "Let us make man in our image." There's been a lot of ink spilled on exactly what that phrase is describing when God said this, but I think James Boyce has it correct when he concludes that being made in God's image is that man is made for an eternal communion with God. Man is made for an eternal communion with God. It's a promise that we will be eternal. So God is eternal, his promises are eternal, and finally then, we have the hope of this ourselves. Matthew Barrett, in his book on the attributes of God, I think it's called None Greater maybe, he said this, considering this prospect of eternal life. He said, while an eternal God is a comfort to believers, reassuring them of eternal life to come, an eternal God is an eternal torment to unbelievers, perpetually reminding them of the torment to come. Sinclair Ferguson wrote a chapter of the book, Hell Under Fire. And in that chapter, he reminds the readers that Jesus, of all the New Testament teachings, is Jesus who speaks on this topic of hell the most. In fact, if he were teaching, you would just as likely hear Jesus discuss the prospect of hell as you would the preciousness of heaven itself. If you were to pull together all of the teachings on hell, assemble them in the New Testament, I think two categories would emerge. The first is that hell is eternal. Revelation chapter 20, verse 10. In this day of judgment, the devil comes before the Lord and he's banished. It says this is the devil, it was the beast and the false prophets. It says they will be tormented day and night. And as if that wasn't enough, day and night, forever and ever. Then just after that, you begin to read a little bit further down. It then begins to discuss those names who have not been written in the book of life. And what will become of them? And it says that those names who've not been written in the book of life, they too will have that same fate. That they will be placed in this lake of burning sulfur, and they will live there forever and ever. Jesus says the same thing, Matthew chapter 25, in the day of judgment. He says that the fate of the devil is the same fate of those who are not in Christ. I honestly can't absorb that news when I think of those in my life and in my family. The weight of that is difficult, isn't it? He goes on to say even more, though. It's eternal, and it's eternal suffering. Three words are given to the suffering. First, it's conscious. There is no morphine. They will experience it in a way that they are conscious of it. No anesthesia. Eternal, conscious, emotional suffering, regret, remorse, and sorrow, day after day after day. Physical, gnashing of teeth. Sinclair Ferguson goes on to say, some people make the case that when the Bible speaks of hell in those terms, it's speaking of it metaphorically, that those are metaphors. Ferguson goes on to say, they're right. But metaphors, the purpose of metaphor is to use language for something that's actually greater. In other words, the words that are being used still don't characterize what that will in fact be. It's said that on one occasion, a member of the British family came up to an Anglican priest. And she asked him the question, she asked whether or not there was a hell or not. And the Anglican priest replied, "Ma'am, our Lord and apostles taught so. Our creeds affirm so, and our churches believe so." To which she said, "Well, then why in God's name do you not tell us so?" And the point is that as we consider this good news that is ours in Christ, we ought to remember what our Savior held both of them together. To communicate the good news, we need to be a people who communicate the bad news as well. As we think about this good news, I want to take you back. There's on every page of Scripture, the good news can be found. I want to use a text from the Gospel of John where Jesus kind of slides us back before creation again. John chapter 6, Jesus says this. He said, "And this is the will of him." He's talking about God the Father. "And this is the will of him who sent me, that I shall lose none of those he has given me, but raise them up on the last day." Listen, this might be my favorite text in the whole of Scripture. What he's saying is that he's going back to this inner Trinitarian deliberation, and he's saying at that particular time, God the Father set a will into motion, a will that the Trinity covenanted together to ensure what was going to happen. And Jesus says that that will was in part to ransom and to save. And Jesus says, those to whom the Father willed, he said, I will lose none of them. That's the best news. There are days when I wake up that I just know I have to be forgotten. There are days that I wake up that I think to myself, I'm not going to make it to the end. And yet there is these promises that the Lord has given. And Jesus says, those to whom the Father has given me, I will lose none. And then he goes on and he paints this beautiful picture. He said that I will raise them up on the last day. It's this picture of what life will be like with them. It's this picture of what life will be like in heaven. Mentioned 276 times in the New Testament. The land of no mores. No more sorrow. No more tears. No more cancer. No more phone calls about emergency surgeries. No more death. That's what awaits us. And that is the news that the Lord holds before us. I've got this lengthier quote here. I'm going to read to you. It's Puritan language a little bit. I hope it'll be a blessing to us. It's a blessing to me this week. As God is, so will the eternity of him be. Without change, without division, the fullness of joy will be always present. Without past to be thought of with regret for being gone, without future to be expected with tormenting desires. When we enjoy God, we enjoy him in his eternity without any flux, without the passing away of pleasures that may be wished to return, or expectation of future joys which might be desired to hasten. After many ages, the joys will be as savory and satisfying as if they had been but that moment first tasted by our hungry appetites. That's what heaven is going to be like. This week, I remembered a story that you can turn this down. This week, I remembered a story that I'd heard earlier in this year of Colin O'Brady. Colin O'Brady, at the end of 2018, did something that no other person had ever accomplished. He completed an unaided, unsupported trek across Antarctica, leaving from the Atlantic Ocean, going via the South Pole to the Pacific Ocean. Now, others have done this trip with support, where they'll drop supplies along the way, and they used kites to harness the wind to pull them along. When I heard that, I thought, well, yeah, anybody can do that, right? No, that's a joke. But he was the first person who set out to be unaided, unsupported, meaning, and the largest, the most difficult task for him was to bring enough food for this trip. When he started, he had 300-pound sled behind him. Antarctica, there was no, it was sunlight all the time. The winds were, there were days where it was difficult just to walk one step, he would say. He said, complete whiteout. It was 932 miles that he set out to walk, and it took him a total of 54 days to do it. At one point, and I think the most remarkable part of this story, it estimated that on an average day, he would burn 10,000 calories per day. What was most amazing to me was on the last day, it was Christmas Day of this past year, he woke up and he had 80 miles in front of him. Now, to that point, he was averaging 17 miles per day. He woke up and he said, today's the day. I'm going to finish it. And he got up and he started to trek across. And he trekked the entire 80 miles without stopping. When I heard this story, it just resonates something deep within me. This fortitude and this strength that despite all odds, the ability to move beyond what seems possible to possible. You know why I think we need to contemplate God's eternality. Because when we think about this eternal God, it causes us to think about these eternal promises that are ours. It causes us to remember that there was a promise made from eternity past. God the Father, God the Son, God the Spirit locked together and said, I will redeem a people for my own. And when we think on that truth, and when we think on what is ours in Christ, every single day will be sweeter and sweeter and sweeter than it just will make us a different people. Too much of our time is spent here. And when we really do consider the attributes of God in new ways, it will change us day by day. Let's pray. Father, we know that we are changing day by day. And yet we take great comfort to know that you are an unchanging God. We take great comfort to know that with you there is no beginning and there is no end. We take great comfort to know that your promises never change. They are eternally secure. And that those who are in Christ will experience eternal life with you. Father, if there is even one tonight who does not have that assurance, who does not know the joy of being in Christ, would you call them from this far country and give them salvation? Amen.
I invite you to stand with us.
Yeah.
Please raise your hand for the Lord's benediction. May the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit, who covenanted themselves together that you might have the hope of eternity, bless you and equip you for all you stand in need of this week. Amen.